That's how you change the world. 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 Amen. Well, I want to take this time to welcome you all to Community Life Church. This is a wonderful day. It's a day that the Lord has made. We'll rejoice and be glad in this day. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Those of you who are watching us from different parts of the world, you're online. We want to welcome our online church. Thank you so much for joining us today. It's such a privilege for us to be with you in fellowship today. Wherever you're watching from, do drop us a comment in the comment section and let us know where you're watching from. We will be sure to welcome you. Last weekend, we were excited when we were joined by a couple that has been watching us in California since March. They've been online watching us and following us. And last weekend, we were privileged to be with them in the service. While they were in the country, they called me up and said, "We'd like to come to your church. Will you drop us a pin?" And sure, we did. And last weekend, they came and joined us. We're so grateful. So please, wherever you are, if you're ever in the Kampala area in Uganda, feel free to reach out to us and we'll be very happy to connect you and let you know where we are located so that we can fellowship with you. It's always a good thing to be with brothers and sisters in the Lord. I want to take this time to thank you all who are faithfully continuing to give in your tithes and offerings. That goes a long way in helping us to continue with the work of God here at Community Life Church as we move into our communities and transform and bring transformation and change our lives for the glory of His name. So thank you so much for giving, and please keep giving. There are many avenues. You can come and give at the church. You can give through mobile money, direct bank transfers, etc. You can give through any way that's convenient for you, and you will be helping us to continue to extend the kingdom of God. Well, we are in our Tugende series. We continue, and today is week number 4. And the first week, we looked at who the church is, and we said the church is people and not a place, and it's about people. The second week, we looked at the characteristics of a church, of a healthy church. The third week, we looked at how we must walk as a church. And today we're going to be looking at church is about God's grace. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for what we're going to study today. We pray that you'll speak to our hearts and change us and bring transformation in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1, we're going to study. But before we do that, Tugende 3:16, what's it all about? It's about telling your story, how God has been wonderful in your life, how God has changed your life, and inviting and bringing people into the kingdom of God. That's what it's all about. Tugende is a Luganda word meaning let's go. 3:16 is basically John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. So basically we're saying, let's go John 3:16. Tell our stories and lead as many people into the kingdom of God. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 1, it says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of you Gentiles." And we're going to just take time to delve into this portion of scripture. And we've been studying in the book of Ephesians in the last 4 weeks. Paul is writing this particular letter while he's under a house arrest. He has been chained, he's been bound, he's been imprisoned, he has no freedom, he's in difficulty. He's going through lots of suffering. He's in jail. And you and I know that jail is not a wonderful place to be, because when you're there, you lose lots of things like freedom and so many other things. And so Paul is under house arrest. And he says, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ, for the sake of you Gentile. And Paul is under house arrest and he cannot move. He cannot do anything that he would have freely done if he were alone. But Paul does not say, I, Paul, a prisoner of Caesar, because he had been imprisoned by Caesar. In reality, he was a prisoner of Caesar. But he chooses to look beyond Caesar and he looks to Christ, because he is only in Caesar's prison because of Christ. He says, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ. And for the sake of Jesus Christ, I have been locked, I have been put in jail. And the truth be told, what Paul is actually doing right now, he's looking beyond the situation. He's looking beyond the circumstance. And he's saying, I am not a prisoner of Caesar. I am not a prisoner of the circumstance that I'm found in right now. This situation will not consume me. Caesar does not have a final say over my life. The troubles I am facing right now will not control or have no control over me. But Jesus Christ has control over my life. That's why he says, I, Paul, I am a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Now, I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what situation that is disturbing your life right now. But there is no problem that will overtake your life. There is no problem that has a final say over your life. There is no challenge that has a final say over your life. Only God has the final say in your life. We usually sing that song that says, who has the final say? Jehovah has the final say. And we say, Jehovah turns my life around. Jehovah turns my story around. Jehovah retells my story. My story is going to be retold by Jehovah. And we say only Jehovah has the final say. Why? Because we look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Jesus, the author and the finisher of our... And that's why Paul says, I, Paul, I am a prisoner of hope. Whatever you're going through today, I just want to let you know that there's no circumstance or situation that has a right over your life. As long as you keep focused on Jesus Christ, losses will come, but they will go. When you have a loss and you fix your eye on Jesus Christ, you become a prisoner of Jesus Christ. That will come and that will go. A loss will come and it will go. People may come against you, but that wave will come and it will go. Why? Because your eyes are focused on Jesus Christ. As long as our eyes are focused on the cross, at the cross, as long as our eyes are focused at the cross, let me tell you, my friends, my brothers and my sisters, as long as our eyes are focused at the cross, there's no situation that will become too challenging that we will not be able to overcome that. Christ must be the one that we hang on. I'm not sure, again, what you're going through right now, but only Christ has the answer. You may not understand what you're going through, but God understands. You may have no control over what you're going through, but God has control over what you're going through. You may not be able to fully comprehend how the answer will come, but God is going to bring the answer. And that is, and you know, it's amazing. You don't understand what you're going through, but God understands. You don't know how the answer is going to, but God knows. And this is what Paul says in Ephesians 3. This is what he calls a mystery. It becomes a mystery to us. It becomes a mystery to us. You have been going through so many challenging things, but finally you're able to go through that situation. And it's a mystery how you go through it. But in Ephesians 3, Paul calls this a mystery. And when he mentions of a mystery, in chapter 3, he mentions this word mystery four times. And in all his writings, he mentions the word mystery 21 times. And as he's mentioning this word, he's basically not meaning that this is mystical. But he's saying, it's a mystery and I have found the mystery. And I'd like to share this mystery with you. And I'm going to talk about two ways that Paul unveils the mystery. The title of our message today is Church is About God's Grace. Now, the number one way that Paul unveils this mystery is the nature. He talks about the nature of a mystery, which is the grace of God. The nature of a mystery is the nature of God. And then number two, he talks about the venture of a mystery, which is the church of God. Let's begin with number one, the nature. What's the nature of a mystery that Paul talks about here? The nature of a mystery is the grace of God. Let me tell you, it only takes the grace of God that you can look beyond the difficult situation that you're going through right now and focus your eyes on Jesus Christ. And so in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 2, he says, "Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me for you. That is the mystery made known to me by revelation." The administration of God's grace. The word administer there means given. It means given. So when he says, "Surely you have heard about the administration of God's grace that was given to me," he's basically saying the grace of God that has been given to me. God has given me the grace. That's what he's talking about. Remember, he's been jailed, but he's talking about the grace that God has given to him. And I want to let you know that we all exist by the grace of God. And all that we have and all that we are is by the grace of God. So God has given you and I grace. Just begin to paint this picture. If you have an album, go back and get your album. Look at when you are, let's say, 3 years or 4 years. And look at where you are today. By the grace of God, you have been able to live from 3 years to 17, from 3 years to 25, from 3 years to 45, from 3 years to, 50 years to 70 and so on. While many have gone, it's by the grace of God that you are alive today. It's by the grace of God that you have what you have today. You had nothing, but today he has blessed you. He's given you money. He's given you clothing. By the grace of God, he has provided. He's given you a job by the grace of God. You are single, but today you are married. It's by the grace of God, because there are many that have loved to get married, but they're not. You had no children, but you have children today. It's by the grace of God that you have children. By the grace of God that you have been able to study from secondary school from primary school to secondary school to university. You have been able to study. Let me go back. By the grace of God, you have that woman. You have that man that you are married to. Some of you may be saying, "Oh, Pastor, you don't know. This man or this woman is a problem to me." But it's by the grace of God that you're married to them. By the grace of God that you have been able to obtain property. I was reading a story today of one of the comedians who was being teased, and they were teasing him and they were just congratulating him from coming out of rent and getting his own house. And he's been able to secure a house for his family by the grace of God. And then, ultimately by the grace of God that we have been able to give our lives to Jesus Christ. It's by the grace of God that we are saved today. Not because of our works. We are not saved because of our works, but we are saved by the grace of God. Salvation is by grace alone. And through faith alone and in Christ alone. Let me say that again. Salvation is by grace alone, through faith alone, and in Christ alone. In Christ alone, our hope is found. In Christ alone, our hope is blessed. So by grace, it's a mystery. It's a mystery how God can pick me up, how of all people he can choose to pick me up and, you know, transform me, make me a transformed man and make you a transformed woman by the grace. It's a mystery that God, even while we were still sinners, he could still send Christ to come and die for us. That is a mystery. And that's the mystery that Paul is basically talking about here. The nature of a mystery is the grace of God, the grace of God that is upon our lives. And that's why in verse 2, the second part of verse 2, he says, that is the mystery made known to me by revelation. Many times we think we must have money because you've had money for a while. You think you must have money always in your pocket. You think you must always run that business. You think you must always, you know, you must have children automatic when you get married. You think you must have a car. You think you must have a house. You think it's automatic to get married. We think that all this we must have and we take it for granted. But it's by the grace of God that we are able to have this. And when you receive this revelation, that's why he says, it's a revelation. This was revealed to me. Revelation for this mystery. It was revealed to me by the grace of God. I don't deserve what I have. I don't deserve who I am. I don't deserve to be where I am. I don't even deserve the love of God, but it's by the grace of God. And that's what makes it a mystery. It's a mystery, but it's a mystery. And this mystery has been revealed to me by the grace of God. God has given us grace. He has given you and I grace. I don't know what your life story is. There was a time when I had no food, when I only ate one meal a day. But today, I'm able to eat as much as I want. I can only be able to skip when I want to skip. And I call that the grace of God. There was a time when I didn't know where my school fees would come from. But today, I've studied and I continue to be in school. And that's the grace of God. There was a time when, you know, I had no a place to stay, but today I have a place to stay, and that's the grace of God. That is my story. What is your story? What are the things that are happening in your life that when you look back, you say it's only by the grace of God that I am who I am today and I'm doing what I'm doing today? What is your life story? Maybe if you told your life story, somebody's life would be changed. Somebody's life would be encouraged. Here in Uganda, in Luganda, we say Jemvude. What is your Jemvude, the story? What is your Jemvude? You know, if you tell your story, somebody's life could be changed. Tell your story. The nature of a mystery is the grace of God. The grace of God that has abound in our lives, that has reached out to us. It's amazing grace. That is what draws us to continue to focus on Christ. And the second point I want to talk about here, which will be the last one, is the venture of the mystery is the church of God. The venture of a mystery is the church of God. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 10, he says this. His intent was that now, through the church, and note that, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly realms. In the heavenly realms. Now, the venture here will be the word, we can replace that word with mission. The mission, all right? The mission of the mystery is through the church of God. The mission, the avenue through which God wants to communicate his wisdom, the avenue through which God wants to communicate his power, the avenue through which God wants to communicate his blessing, the avenue through which God wants to communicate his love is the church. God has saved you to use you. God has saved you to work with you.
You are God's avenue, and He wants to use you to communicate love, to communicate wisdom, to communicate power, to communicate blessing, to communicate, you know, whatever He wants to communicate. You and I are God's mouthpiece on the earth. And the church is God's avenue to communicate God's grace. But we are saved unto good works. We are not saved by our good works, but we are saved unto good work. Good works, which means when we give our lives to Christ, we are supposed to exhibit good works. We are saved so that we can express our good works, and so that this will draw men and women and children to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. What are some of the good works that you are exhibiting today? Because the mission, the avenue that God wants to use to express His grace is the church. His grace is the church. We're saying that the church is about God's grace. But the avenue through which God wants to experience His grace is the church. So what are some of the good works that we can do, that you and I can do to express or to show God's amazing grace? You know, we have many privileges, and we have been privileged that we have been, that we have given our lives to Christ. But with this privilege, with this benefit, comes responsibility. And the responsibility here is for us to release God's grace, to release God's love, because we have been given grace, which is a mystery, and we release that same grace to others. Now, Jesus' reputation is in the hands of His followers. You and I are His followers, and His reputation is in your hands, is in my hands. God desires to bless His people. God desires to continue to love His people. But God does not just desire to bless His people. He wants to bless them through you. In fact, let me say it this way. God desires to bless you. God wants to bless you. But He just doesn't want to bless you. He wants to bless you so that you can be a blessing. He told Abraham, I will bless you so that you can be a blessing. And God wants to use you to be the avenue of His love, to be the avenue of His healing, to be the avenue for salvation. God wants to use you and I. And we are saying today, that, you know, the church is about God's grace. He has shown us His grace so that we can be able to show other people His grace. And through you and I being the avenue, men and women will come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. I don't know what you're going through today, but whatever you're going through today, we began by saying focus on Jesus, because you are God's child, and you being God's child, He wants to use you to reveal His mysteries on the earth. Hallelujah. Well, I hope that, you know, you can allow God to use you, and that you can allow, you know, the situations not to consume you, but you can allow to be used of God to show, or to be that avenue through which His mysteries will come through. I hope that you can allow to be that avenue through which God's grace shall flow. Amen. And I want to take this moment right now to pray for you wherever you are, that God, that you will allow God to use you. I also want to pray for you if you're going through a hard moment right now, that God will take you through those challenging moments. But first, I want to pray for those who don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Wherever you are, this is the beginning of the receiving of the grace of God. Lord Jesus, say this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for my life. I come before you, have done many things wrong. Come into my life and come into stay. From this day onwards, I receive your grace in Jesus' name. Amen. That's a mystery, that your life now has been changed
you begin a brand new journey. It's as if you have never sinned. You have been justified. You begin on a new slate. Write to us and let us know where you gave your life to, Christ from, and we want to help you grow in Christ. If you're in the area of Kampala, come. We're located in Natete. We'll help you to grow. If you're elsewhere in the world, find a great Bible-based church, join that church, and you will be blessed. Right now, before I pray for all of you who are going through challenges, let me allow Rebecca to come, and then I will come back right after that and pray for a miracle for all of you.
Welcome back from the sermon, and I hope that you have been greatly blessed. As you know, giving at Community Life Church is an act of worship, and generosity is one of our core values. So we would love to thank all of you that have faithfully given in your tithes and your offerings. They have helped us to impact the community and to do the Lord's work. God has been so good to us, even through this season of the pandemic. Indeed, it has been a year of increase. We have been able to acquire our church land, and for the past 2 weeks, work has been ongoing to make it a comfortable home for us to worship the Lord freely. We thank all of you that have joined and believed the CLC vision through your giving and your generosity. We encourage you to continue giving towards the work that the Lord has started. The heart of the generous only grows bigger and bigger.
Well, thank you so much, Rebecca. Let me pray for you right now. Father, thank you so much for every man and woman that's watching from wherever they're watching from. I believe you, oh God, for a miracle. You have done many miracles. 2 weeks ago, there was a lady that was sick that we prayed for, and she got healed. You have healed her. She could not sleep, but today she's sleeping. 2 weeks ago, you healed two people who had back issues. Spine issues, you heal them completely. And today, we are believing you for a miracle. For anybody that's watching us today, I believe you for a miracle for them. Lord, those that are sick in their bodies, that you'll come and heal them right now. Those that are challenged in their businesses, that you'll provide for them. Those that are looking, oh God, to be married, I pray, oh God, that you'll open doors. Those that are looking for children, I pray that there will be a miracle that will come right now. So I speak and release the blessing upon, blessing of God upon you all, wherever you're watching from. And speak life into your families, and speak life into your businesses, and speak life into your academics, and speak life in whatever you're doing right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. The blessing of Abraham and the blessing of Jacob rest upon you all, and the blessing of Isaac rest upon you all. The blessing, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you. The Lord be gracious to you and lift up his countenance on you, and may you find yourselves acceptable in his sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you so much for joining us today. And until next time, God richly bless you. Be sure to have a wonderful week, and we'll keep praying for you. Join in with a friend next time. God bless you from Community Life Church. We love you very much, and have a victorious week.
There's no fear, 'cause I believe. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over.